Good morning, YouTube. Welcome to The Truth According to Lily. I am your host, Lily. And this morning, we're going to be talking about Star Trek Discovery, Episode 5, Choose Your Pain. Which, there's a lot of pain in this episode. It's pretty sad. Some revelations. Can't... Must you? Here. Come here. Come hither, little one. So this episode, like I said, had a lot of revelations. The revelation that they're really harming the tardigrade, the revelation what happened to Lorca's previous command, and why everyone's kind of, like, standoffish about him. There was the introduction of Lieutenant Ash Tyler, which there's a fan theory that I was, that someone sent to me on Tumblr, which I will talk about later. I personally think this was probably the best episode so far in the season. I mean, they just keep getting better and better and better, and this episode did not disappoint whatsoever. It was a really, really good episode of TV, even though it's a streaming service, so it's not really TV. It was a great episode of streaming service entertainment. Scary. So this episode is pretty much just centered around Captain Lorca being kidnapped and taken hostage by the Klingons, which was not fun for anybody involved. That was really rough. There were some really rough moments in that. Well, now we know why he's not, you know, friends with anyone on Discovery. that was really sad, and it kind of brings Captain Lorca's arc home that, you know, a month into the war, his ship was boarded by Klingons, and so he made the horrible, really, and I don't mean horrible as in bad, but that's, you know, neither, that's really fairly ambiguous. I mean horrible in the sense that he made the decision to just blow them all up instead of letting them be taken as prisoners and tortured slowly and painfully and publicly. And oh my god. It's like, no, I didn't let them die. I blew them up. It was great. Really fantastic performance by Jason Isaacs. Just, it made me really fall in love with this character. So, it was just fantastic. Really, really great. And I liked that we learned more about him in this kind of setting, you know, where it's kind of, he's outed, so he's kind of forced to reveal his past, especially to, you know, poor Ash Tyler, who is idealistic and immediately wants to kind of protect this captain. That's not even his captain, it's just his duty to protect the captain. So, that was pretty interesting. It also brings some things into perspective as to why Lorca's trying to make the crew of Discovery realize what's at stake. People's lives are in danger, your lives are in danger every single day, and, like, yeah, it's awesome that we're on a science vessel that's, like, state of the fucking art, and nobody has a ship like it, but people are going to die, kind of a thing. He's made peace with that, but he's trying to get the rest of the crew to see it, like, not necessarily his way, but the realistic way. So, yeah, I think his cross to bear is one of the heaviest. So I think that's why he really understands Burnham and sees a bit of his own, you know, past in her, because, you know, she's responsible for the deaths of thousands of people, and he was responsible for the death of killing his entire crew. So I think he just gets it, and I think that's why he wasn't antagonistic to her when she first got there, and why he extended a second chance to her. Because he gets that call that she had to make, or was trying to make. I loved everything that happened with Saru and Michael. Like, there was they finally actually, especially Saru, he finally just, like, bared his soul and said, you know, I really didn't care for the way that you just swooped in and became first officer and stole my chance, basically, and that he was jealous and angry and resentful, and they were able to, you know, finally talk about their feelings, especially Saru. He was finally able to talk about it, and I feel like there was really closure with this episode as far as Saru and Michael goes. Definitely felt like there was closure, especially when she gives him the telescope. And, you know, throughout the whole show so far, he's been saying that she's dangerous, that, you know, she's basically a killer. And then he places his trust and faith in her and tells her to save the tardigrade's life, which I think was just, like, a really big deal for Michael. Not necessarily that she got his approval or anything like that, but that it's the beginning stages of working to build the foundation of trust between the two of them again, which I really liked, because I really would like them to be friends. And I see the beginning stages of friendship being weaved throughout this show, because it wouldn't have made sense that they'd all be besties at the beginning of it, given the circumstances, given who Michael is. But now, you can kind of see her building different friendships with Tilly and a better work relationship with Stamets, better work relationship with Saru. Oh, something that I thought was really sweet and cute. Michael is in the Lorca menagerie, and she's talking to Dr. Kolber about the tardigrade. After their whole conversation, before he leaves, he kind of just pats her on the back and stuff like that. Like, he's not a dick to her. Like, so far, Lorca and Kolber are the only ones who haven't been dicks to her. Well, and Tilly. Well, Tilly was kind of a dick, a little bit. She was a little bit of a dick. Because as soon as she found out who Michael was, she was kind of like, oh, I can't be seen with you. Even though she apologized. But I don't know, it was just nice to see Kolber being like, you're doing a good job, it's okay, kind of a thing. It was just nice. I really loved when Stamets injected himself with the tardigrade DNA compound, and it was really moving and very self-sacrificing. I feel like the things that Saru asked the computer to, you know, like, list about what makes a captain, like, a great captain, you know, bravery, self-sacrifice, all those, compassion. I feel like we saw a lot of that in this episode, you know, what's the measure of a captain and stuff like that, because Saru's struggling with that, and then you have your actual captain in prison, basically, and then you have all these other characters that are trying to struggle with the morality of what they're doing. It's a sentient life, it's a sentient creature, should we really be torturing it in a way? Because, yeah, it's helping us get to our end goal, but at what cost? It's life, essentially, and Saru's so desperate to find a solution that he doesn't really see that. It's not so much that he's not taking it seriously, it's just that he does not want to fail. Like, it's not an option. Failure is not an option for Saru in this scenario. And holy shit, Star Trek said fuck. Twice. Two fucks. They had two fucks to give. I thought that was great. I thought it was great that it was Tilly that said fuck. I thought it was just, that made me like her even more. The Easter egg, the holy Easter egg that showed up when Saru was talking to the computer was really great, except for, you know, the inclusion of Jonathan fucking Archer. You guys all know how I feel about the man who played water polo. It's like, really? Like, I still don't understand that. Like, I think the guy was from, like, the Midwest or something like that, and he likes water polo. It's just like, why not rock climbing? Like, why not football? Why not baseball? You literally have so many sports that Captain Archer could have been, like, super hardcore about, and you chose fucking water polo. Lame. Another reason to hate Captain Archer. But it's kind of like, okay, I see them including Captain Archer, whether canonically he's a very highly decorated Starfleet captain or not. It was kind of like that moment in Rogue One when Jimmy Smits showed up, and everyone was just like, oh yeah, you were in the prequels. Oh, you were in the prequels. It kind of made you nervous for about 2.5 seconds, but then you kind of realize, oh no, this is just a way, this is a filmmaker's way of, and a storytelling way, to pay homage to shitty movies that are canon. But, you know, you have to include them in some way. And that's what the Jimmy Smits cameo was like, and this is what the Jonathan Archer name on the screen was like. You know, we're just like, yes, we are acknowledging that it's canon, he is canon, but we're moving on from that. Okay, now we're moving on. And hopefully there's no more mention of that son of a bitch's name. I really hate Captain Archer. I fucking hate him. And so far, Captain Lorca is just 10 times the man that Captain Archer was. Captain Archer fucking sucks. I just can't imagine Captain Archer doing something that Lorca did. I can't. Not in a million years. I can't imagine him doing that. God's righteous fucking son. But the cherry on the sundae was Captain Pike's name. I'm not gonna lie. I would really love to see someone, like a young actor, cast as Captain Pike so we can, like, just see him, you know? Because one of the things that, looking back on it, of the J.J. Abrams movies, was the fact that Captain Pike became this mentor to Captain Kirk, which is fine. Like, it's not bad that they did that in this alternate timeline. But subsequently, Spock's relationship with Pike was severed. It was completely severed. In TOS, Spock and Pike served together for like 10 years, something like that. They served together for a really long time. They were friends, and it's a whole section, really, of Spock's life that I've always wished we knew more about. A whole section of Pike's life that I wish we knew more about. I mean, maybe someone's written a novel or something and I just don't know. But I've always felt like Captain Pike got the shaft. Not that, you know, Shatner's awful or anything like that. He's Captain motherfucking Kirk. I mean, like, I love Captain Kirk. But, I don't know, like, I don't know, just cast Sebastian Stan or something like that as Captain Pike. That'd be great. That's the first name I thought of. I don't know why. So, yeah, I thought it was a very good episode. Very dark, very eye-opening to a lot of things. You really learn a lot about certain characters. Oh, Rainn Wilson, by the way, was fantastic as Harry Mudd. Like, I really have no complaints about him whatsoever. I wasn't a huge fan of the character in TOS. I kind of skipped over some of his episodes, to be honest. But Rainn Wilson was really good. I loved his costume. It was really great. Very scene-stealing. I thoroughly enjoyed that. It's fan theory time, bitches. I only have one fan theory. This was presented to me last week, after last week's episode on Tumblr by Elegant Paws. Okay, so the fan theory is Lieutenant Ash Tyler is Vok in disguise. I think this would be interesting, given that the moment I clapped eyes on Ash, I thought it was a little too convenient. However, despite this, the scenes I loved the most in this episode were actually with Lorca, Ash, and Mudd. Like, I thought those were some of the best scenes, because it was some of the most revealing, not including Saru bearing his feelings finally and getting all that shit off his chest. The scenes with Lorca, Ash Tyler, and Mudd were very revealing. It just seemed a little too convenient that Ash happened to be in the right place at the right time and said all of the really right things to Lorca. It was just like, yeah, I lost a captain. Yeah, so did Vok. Vok was also at the Battle of the Binary Stars. It was just, and Laurel sent Vok away to the matriarchs of her house. So, the only problem I have with this fan theory is, do the Klingons even have technology to do that? I mean, I know Laurel's house is the deceivers and liars and stuff like that, but can they really make a Klingon a man? I don't know. Like, that's the only problem I have with this fan theory, is that if it is true, it's gotta be a really, really good explanation as to why Vok is not Klingon anymore. Another, like, well, why did he free, if he's actually a spy in disguise, if he is really Vok and he is actually Klingon, why did he blow up at the captain of the ship? I mean, it could just be because he's super pissed that he's no longer Klingon and he wanted to take it out on somebody and it was just all for show, or maybe he lost his memory. I don't know. When you watch all of Ash Tyler's scenes with the context that it could be Vok, it does make sense. But then it's a very easy theory to poke holes into. It's very easy to poke holes in this theory. Okay, so I did a little digging, because I'm a fucking nerd like that. The actor who plays Vok is only listed for 3 episodes. The last episode he was listed for was last week's. The Butcher's Knife Cares Not for the Lamb's Cry. But the actor who plays Ash Tyler has been listed for 15 episodes. But the actor who plays Vok is not listed for any more episodes in the rest of the season. Which is kind of weird when you think about it, considering the fact that this is a main antagonist that we've been following, and suddenly he's just not in the show anymore, or he's still in the show, just in a different capacity. Also, the actor who plays Vok is like a fucking ghost. The guy has never been in. If you look at his IMDb page, Star Trek Discovery is literally the only thing that he has credit to. Could just be an unknown actor, but if he's a main antagonist for the rest of the show, why isn't he listed as anything? Like, why isn't he listed for more episodes? Ash Tyler is. The guy who plays Ash Tyler is listed for 15 episodes. I'm just saying. Like, it could be. Like literally, the actor who plays Vok is literally, like, a fucking ghost. There's no pictures of him outside of his makeup. There's no pictures of him getting makeup applied. It's also really interesting that Ash Tyler has a bruise, or it almost looks like a scar. I mean, it could be a bruise because he was getting shit kicked out of him a lot. Under the same eye that Burnham scratched in episode 2. I mean, that could just be me reading way too much into it, but it seems pretty fucking convenient. And that last line with him and Lorca when they get back to Discovery, and Ash just says, "Oh no, I'm right where I want to be." I mean, like, it's a really good theory. I'm not gonna lie. Like I said, you can poke some holes through it, but they kind of just mend themselves in a way. And I mean, I think it'd be really cool. I'm the one who said last week that Lorca was from the 29th century, and slowly my little fan theory heart is being shattered into a million fucking pieces. But doesn't make him any less of an awesome character. My only concern is how they would execute Vok being Tyler, Tyler being Vok. And, you know, it would be his sweetest revenge. And what would he be even... Oh my god, what would be even more mind-blowing is if, like, he tries to seduce Burnham. Oh my fuck. And that's, like, his ultimate revenge. And, like, he's so fucked. Revenge fucking. Really horrible. But yeah, that's just the theory that was presented to me last week by Elegant Pause. And I think it's a fun theory to entertain. Either that or... I just don't believe Ash's intentions are completely noble, and he's definitely... He's just too convenient. He just showed up at the right time. Like... And he really played into Lorca's story, and he really played into the whole belief in Starfleet and that I have to keep my captain alive kind of a thing, and in a scenario where Lorca needed to stay alive. Which sucks, because I love the way, I mean, if it's not true, I still love, whether it's true or not, I love the way Ash and Lorca, like, worked together. That was fantastic. And something that I thought was interesting was that, kind of an old school homage, I guess, was Lorca calling Ash soldier. He's not calling him an officer or anything like that. You know, he's not saying his rank, he's saying soldier, you know, and he's moving him along. I think it just plays more, and I thought that was very much in character. I really liked it. I thought it was a really good episode. Like I said, I think this has been my favorite episode so far. Just fucking great. Really fantastic storytelling, and I'm really glad the tardigrade is free, and then he's happy, and he can go be a space thing, whatever he is, somewhere else, and be free and not have prongs sticking in his body, and animal abuse is just horrible. Oh yeah, and real quick, the ending of the episode with Culver and Stamets, and they have those really cool space toothbrushes. I guess they've eliminated the needing to spit when you brush your teeth in the future, which is great. Nod to, yep, here comes the mirror universe, here it motherfucking comes. I wonder if that's why we didn't get a trailer. I don't know if anybody else noticed, but, like, at the end of episode 5, there was no trailer for next week, which I was like, fuck. That shit ain't cool, bro. Also, side note, getting green misted is a really horrible way to die, or being turned into green mist. Whatever, that was pretty fucked up. I mean, if I was the one who pulled the trigger and I didn't know what was gonna come out of that fucking phaser blaster, I would've been like, the fuck did I just do to that person? But, you know, desperate times. I don't know, I feel like this review kind of sucks, but I'm also tired and... I haven't eaten yet. I don't know why I always film my videos before I've eaten. Or could get sexier by the episode. Like, I'm definitely shipping him with myself. I'm sorry. No, I'm not. As long as he doesn't like water polo, I'm fine with his hobbies. If his hobby is war, great. It's not fucking water polo. Just saying. I need to stop talking. Puppy snuggles, you got a chunky belly. This is just my thoughts/review video. I hope you enjoyed it. Sorry if I don't sound that enthusiastic. Like I said, I'm very hungry and I never eat before my videos for some asinine reason. Thank you for watching. Live long and prosper. May the force be with you, and stay tuned and turned on for more. Again, thank you to Elegant Paws on Tumblr for sending the fan theory my way. Much appreciated. And if anybody else has any fan theories, even if they're super ridiculous, send them my way, because I love ridiculous fan theories. They're always fantastic. Always. Usually better than what actually happens in the show.